Well, good morning to all of these wonderful faces out here. Hoyt, you too. If you'll stand and let's sing 380. There's a heart in my melody, and within my heart there is a melody. That one there instead of the one I read, and it's in your both in your hymnal as well as up on the screen. Take a moment and greet those around you. Glad to see everybody's doing real well this morning. Now we're going to sing Just a Little Talk with Jesus, 3107 in your hymnal or up on the screen.
Let us
talk with Jesus.
Let us
If you'll say with me the Apostles' Creed found in 881 in your hymnals. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, and was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated, sir. Be seated. Glad to see so many wonderful and shining faces out there. There are several announcements to be made today. First of all, if you will please sign your pew pads that are found at the end of each pew. If you're a visitor here, we will hopefully like to contact you and maybe give you a nice chicken pie. There are still some Brunswick stew left, I believe, out in the fellowship hall. It's great. If you haven't got any, please feel free to get out there and get some right after we get done here or after Sunday school. GLOW Ministries coming up on March 8th at 7 p.m. a meeting. United Methodist Women are meeting Monday, March 13th at 10:30 a.m. There are several people in the bulletin this week need our prayers. Kathy Brown fell, has a concussion. Alice Flint and Lois Laster, both who have pneumonia and are in the hospital. Jackie Sheely, Kathy Gardner, lung cancer, mother of Shannon Moser. And I want to express my appreciation from my family for all of those who have prayed and sent condolences about my mother's mother, Cleo DeMetzler, who passed away. Memorial service will be Monday at 6 o'clock here. It once again proves that just how caring and wonderful this congregation is. Anytime you have to go through something, it's amazing the support that you have here. And that is one of the reasons why going here is such a wonderful blessing. And thank you again for all that you've did for all the family. So if we go to the Lord now in prayer. Call to worship this morning is 3096, and the response is 895. Flowers are on the altar today are in memory of my grandmother, Cleota Metzler, by her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Will you bow your heads, please? Father, thank you that you have brought each of us safely to this place. We gladly surrender our lives to you in worship and praise. As we gather, we remember those who are not with us today. For those who are sick, we ask for healing. For those who are away from us, we ask for your blessing to be on them. We invite your beautiful Holy Spirit to move freely among us. Come dwell in each of our hearts. Equip us, challenge us, comfort us, teach us. Inspire us as we learn more about your majestic ways. Father, as we meet now, may we behold your beauty and encounter your grace. We ask all of this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Now, if you'll pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. God of wonders, we join with you in the joy of this season of giving. You gave us a Savior who is Christ the Lord. You gave us life and breath. You fill the world with beauty and our hands with bounty and our hearts with the desire to give. Accept these gifts and ourselves and serve us always in every season. Amen. Be seated. Our scripture lesson this morning is John chapter 9, 1 through 41. I just want to see if I got a reaction back here. That's originally what was sent to me, was the whole verses 1 through 41. I'd been up here all day. But it's actually verse 13 through 17. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He put mud on my eyes, the man replied, and I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others asked, how can a sinner perform such signs? So they were divided. When they turned again to the blind man, what have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened. The man replied, he is a prophet. The word of God for the people of God.
Well, actually, you can go home and read the entire chapter 9 in the Gospel of John, since you probably don't have anything else to do this afternoon. I, on the other hand, am going straight from here at noon to teach in Jeff Patterson's district all afternoon on biblical interpretation, and then go back to Guilford College United Methodist Church and serve communion with Nancy Rankin. This is not the time of the year you say no to the district superintendents, if you understand what I mean. I don't mind saying no to them, just not in the year I'm getting a new appointment. But I do want to share with you this amazing passage from John's Gospel, chapter 9, because here it is we discover that Jesus had a lot of critics. Can you believe that? Jesus had critics. Not everyone liked Jesus, especially the religious people. Odd, isn't it? According to the critics, Jesus didn't do the right thing. Jesus didn't go to the right places. Jesus didn't say the right things to the people he should have said the right things to. And Jesus hung around with the wrong people. And worst of all, Jesus just let anyone into the kingdom of God. You could imagine what that was like. Jesus simply scandalized the best people on earth, the most religious people there were at that time. Jesus was known to intimidate the most religious people on earth. He did this by opening the membership in the spiritual life to those who had been denied membership in the kingdom of God. There were plenty of people who had been denied membership in the kingdom of God because they didn't follow all the rules. They didn't sit too well with those in power, if you know what I mean. What really made people furious was that Jesus had this irresponsible habit of throwing the doors open to God's love and God's grace, to the good-for-nothings, to the whosoevers, to the just anyones, and to the not-a-chancers. People a lot like you and me. Nothing makes people in the church more angry than grace. Nothing makes people in the church more angry than grace. It's irony at its best. It's ironic that we stumble into a party we were not invited to, and we find other uninvited folks who are standing at the door making sure that no other people who were not invited will get in. Then a really strange phenomenon occurs. As soon as we are included in the party, because of Jesus' irresponsible love toward those who didn't deserve his love, we decide to make grace even more responsible by becoming self-appointed kingdom monitors standing at the door, guarding the kingdom of God as if it belonged to us and not all those other people. Guarding the kingdom of God as if we were the vineyard owner instead of the vineyard worker. Guarding the kingdom of God as if we were the high priest instead of the one who slops the hogs. Guarding the kingdom of God, keeping the riffraff out, everyone but us, of course. Keeping the riffraff out. Now that's another story of irony. Because as I understand the kingdom of God, and that's who the kingdom of God is supposed to be for, according to Jesus. The Gospel of John tells the story of a man not unlike us, an outsider, a blind outsider. It's a metaphor for us. We are spiritually blind far too often. Of course, we don't want anybody to know it. We pretend, but then there's the real us. And we are a little too good at keeping outsiders where they belong, or at least where we think they belong. When the blind man bumped into Jesus and found healing, he became a scandal to the religious leaders of the day. What they could not see, what they would not see, what we have trouble seeing in ourselves is this. The blind man's miraculous encounter with Jesus is a model for all of us who are trying to live spiritual lives devoted to God. We think we are more like the disciples than we are like the blind man. The disciples, though, bring up some theological questions about whether his blindness was caused by his own sin or the sin of his parents. The disciples are not concerned about the blind man. What they are concerned about is the theology of blindness. Whose fault was it? Looking for someone to blame. Oh my, we are so good at that. The disciples attempt to have a theological discussion out loud. First mistake. Perhaps trying to impress others nearby, that they were raising those kinds of questions. But Jesus cuts it short. Jesus makes it clear that what matters is glorifying God. Helping spiritually blind men and women see. That's what we're called to do. Helping those who are spiritually blind see. Isn't that what we are called to do? The disciples worried about the theology and the theories and the doctrines. Jesus was worried about the blind man. Once Jesus healed the blind man, his troubles really began. This is much like us today. When one loses his or her spiritual blindness, the family is not sure what to do with them. The church is not sure what to do with them. They have never talked like this before. Their closest friends are not as happy with them as they once were. Meeting Jesus does not always result in our troubles ending. Sometimes our troubles just begin when we get to know Jesus. I suppose that's why Jesus says to them and to us, "Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to this earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword." What happens to us when Jesus changes our life? Can other people see that Jesus has changed our life? What happens to us when we finally see the forest just beyond the edge of the trees? When the man who was formerly blind returns to his neighborhood, his neighbors refuse to believe that he can see. They are afraid of the mystery. So are we. They are afraid of the grace of God. So are we. They are afraid of the healing of Jesus. So are we. They were afraid to fathom the possibility of a miracle. So are we. The neighbors turned their backs on their friend and they dragged him to those who should have known something about mystery, miracle, grace, healing, and the spiritual life, the religious leaders, who were also known as the condemners. How should we respond to their intimidation? "Tell us, Mr. Blind Man, how did you get your eyesight back?" Now, the blind man answers in a very strange way. "A stranger made mud with his own spit, stuck it on my eyes, and ordered me to wash it off in the pool of Siloam. I did what he said. Now I can see." The blind man just flunked religion 101. Because the kingdom monitors know more than God about uneducated, uncouth, blind men, or at least they believe they do. Plus, they don't want to learn anything new, especially from a blind man. So they respond with something like this: "Anyone who goes to Sunday school knows that people who are blind from birth are paying for the sins of their family. How can we survive when those around us criticize us and our spiritual life? Or worse, reject us because although we are spiritual, we're just not religious enough to suit them?" Then, of course, it all breaks loose. The story continues. The most religious people on earth, the Pharisees of the day, are nothing more than kingdom monitors who know scripture like the backs of their hand instead of knowing it like the front of their hearts. People should have been ready to celebrate what God had done in the life of this blind man. But instead, because God didn't get their approval first, they are ready to condemn. And oh boy, do they know how to condemn. Can't you just hear them? The real God doesn't use mud to heal people, especially from self-appointed prophets no one has ever heard of. And most certainly, God doesn't heal people on the Sabbath. We know that for sure. Religious people, back in Jesus' day, and all the way through the history to our day, we simply love to hide behind our religion, and we don't put forth our spiritual life. Some people just love the rules of religion more than they love Jesus. But they really love only the rules that they can keep or the rules that they want to keep. The kingdom monitors now try to force the blind man to renounce Jesus by asking him to confirm that Jesus is anything but the Messiah. That in fact, Jesus is a sinner. And what can the blind man possibly say to this? The blind man does something we should do more often than we do. The blind man trusts his own ignorance. And the blind man says, whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I do know, I was blind, and now I can see. The blind man does the only thing he can do. He tells his strange, contradictory, politically incorrect, irrational story. He tells the truth, where all good theology starts. The blind man knows very little about Jesus. He doesn't even know where Jesus is. But he knows what Jesus did in his life. The blind man says, I don't know. Which is not a bad response to the mystery of Christ. Perhaps we should say that a little more often. That's what makes the position that we have with Jesus a mystery. The Pharisees missed the point altogether. It makes me wonder how often we miss the point. It makes me wonder how often that we don't even know there is a point to miss. The Pharisees became so enraged that they physically threw the blind man out of the synagogue, leaving him alone. Telling the truth can get you thrown out of when you least expect it. And here is the biggest tragedy of all. Not one person in the entire chapter 9 of the Gospel of John, including the blind man's parents, do what a follower of Christ should have done. Throw a party. When a man or a woman has just received their spiritual sight, after a lifetime of spiritual blindness, someone should order the food and start the music and begin the celebration. The spiritual life is not just about rules and regulations, which some people think they are. It's not just about teaching and theology or lectures or sermons. Life with Jesus is meant to be lived, not smothered, not judged, not inspected too closely, not condemned, not judged. Did I say judged? The blind man should have had the time of his life at that point. His moment of healing should have been commemorated so that he would never forget, and so that no one else would ever forget. This is the lesson that we should learn for today. Let us celebrate that we are loved by God. Let us celebrate that we don't have to choose to be kingdom monitors or gatekeepers or the people in charge. Let us celebrate that we can be instruments of the grace of God. We can choose not to be Pharisees. We can choose not to be kingdom monitors. We can choose not to be spiritually blind. We can choose to be filled with the grace of God, so much so that we give it away. We live in a world of blame and judgment and bitterness, but we can do better than that. We can live in a world of grace and mercy and love and healing and spiritual healing and emotional healing. Nothing can ever separate us from the love of God. Nobody will ever separate us from the grace of God. So don't ever forget that. Let us pray. Gracious God, you just keep trying to fill our lives with your love and your mercy and your grace and your healing. And much too often we turn our eyes the other way. We close our ears so that we can't hear. And you just keep on trying, pushing us and shoving us and taking us places where we're not that comfortable. So today, Lord, we're going to open our hearts that you can make a difference for each one of us. That we will no longer be spiritually blind, and that we will seek your spiritual healing in our lives. For this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our hymn is number 378, and it will be on the screen.
I'm not afraid.
go from this place with the celebration that God has put in your life. Go from this place with the grace of God and the mercy and the love that you are to give to someone today. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, amen.